My name is Mark Wilson, been in this conference for 4 months and have been banished to the far remotest outposts of the South Australian Conference Empire. We are out at beautiful Port Lincoln and Whyalla, who's doing its tough, and we've got a few folk out at Ceduna as well, so we're enjoying ministry out there. And very, very pleased and happy to come and be with you people. What a wonderful camp meeting. And what a venue! You've got the best venue in the entire country to have a camp meeting in, for sure. So wonderful. And I tell you what, who was here for our first session? If I've come to camp for nothing else than to listen to that meeting, I have been blessed. Amen? And you people have been blessed for, what, 13, 14 years, and having good men like Wolfgang ministering in your midst. Wonderful. It's and we're looking forward to an even to step up, you know. So Sven, you've got a challenge on your hand. Come over, Sven. Let's introduce you. I think I met Sven for the first time when you were working in West Australian Conference.
Yes, that's correct. I came over as an intern. 2006.
Yeah. So 2006, and since then. What have you been doing? You've obviously left Western Australian Conference.
So I started off at North Perth Church, and then I planted, or my wife and I planted, a church at Curtin University, which is one of the universities in Perth. And so that was a really exciting opportunity. And so after 8 years in Perth, we got a call to Sydney.
Yeah.
And so I'm working at the conference office there, working in the area of personal ministries, Sabbath school, stewardship and discipleship. So
excellent.
Yeah.
You've always had a missionary heart, Sven.
Yes, we certainly have. And we've got a vision to plant a number of churches in Sydney. So really praying for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah. Exciting stuff. Now, how's you've got wife and family? How are they coping with all your busyness?
Yeah, well, they're doing well. So my wife Marilyn, she's from Brisbane, and she likes to remind me of that fact, as Queenslanders like to do. And we've got two kids, Samuela, who's 5 years old, and Nathaniel's three. So they keep us on our toes, but yeah, they're lovely additions to our family. Yeah. So,
Well, you've got some exciting stuff to share with us this week.
Yes.
A little kind of preview of what we might be
enjoying. Yeah. Well, really looking at the area of creation and evolution. And so we'll start off today in the reverse order, I guess. We'll start off with evolution and then kind of work our way backwards. But I think it's a very, very fascinating area. And ultimately, as we will discuss tomorrow, one of the things I really believe is sometimes we can really get sort of really focus on the evidence and the data and you know, fossils and DNA and all that kind of stuff. And of course, we need to look at that as well. But I think ultimately the issue is not so much the evidence and the data, but it's the God that we serve. Which is the really most important thing, and who is God like? And that will be the key for our study over the next few days. So,
well, we've fastened our seatbelts. We're ready to go for this series, Sven. We just want to ask the Lord to bless your ministry this week as we enjoy what you have to share with us. We've given you the best auditorium in the country.
Indeed.
And of course, even more so, we've given you the best audience
yes.
in any camp
yes.
meeting that you could possibly come to. So let's pray.
Yes,
and
thank
we'll
you.
Look forward to your meeting. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can be gathered here in this beautiful place out in the Barossa Valley, here at this beautiful auditorium. Amongst beautiful people, Lord, and also with the wonderful presenters that you've given us to bless us throughout this encampment. We ask your special blessing upon Sven, as he shares with us a very timely a series of meetings on the issues of creation, evolution, and our great God is the wonderful creator as well. So bless Sven as he leads us, and be with us now as we meet together in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Thank you. Yes, what I'm going to be sharing with discussing with you today is something which is really close to my heart. for a number of reasons. I guess I have always found these scientific topics really, really fascinating. But not only because I find it personally very fascinating, but it's also a very important part of my spiritual journey as well. Because I didn't start off as a pastor in terms of, you know, when I left high school and all that. I actually started with electrical engineering, and that's where I what I did when I finished high school, and then went on to do research, and loved the maths and the modeling and all that kind of stuff. And then I was thinking about what I wanted to do from then on, and I applied for a number of jobs around the world, and the place which I got accepted for a number, but the one which I decided to accept in the end was a research position at Cambridge University. And it was an amazing experience to go there, to be actually able to walk around the courtyard where, if you remember in Chariots of Fire, they'd race around the courtyard at Trinity College trying to beat the clock. In the preparation for that Olympic race. And also just outside the courtyard, there was a tree where they said, this is the tree where Isaac Newton sat and the apple fell down, and he was like, wow, there's gravity. Amazing to be there. Of course, when you go to England, one of the things you find out is that living is very different from here in Australia. And it's much more cramped. So the first house that I went to in England was a place where they had 5 bedrooms. I was the second person to move in there. I hoped that nobody else would come, so there'd be just the Nicole and myself and maybe somebody else sharing this house. But in reality, what happened, of course, is that 3 other English young people came. And so there we were in this tiny duplex house with 5 people. And it got sort of cramped after a while. And so I was kind of hungering for a place where I could go with a bit more space. And I saw this advertisement on the university website, and it said, if you would like to apply for this place, you can come and have a chat with the landlady. And it looked really amazing. I'd actually seen it before, but hadn't been able to get that particular rental property, or shared property, I should say. And so I went to see her, Jane, and it was such an amazing place. I really had this connection with Jane. She seemed a really friendly kind of person. We had these different things in common. One of the things that we had in common was that she had gone to live in Singapore for a year and lived as a nanny in Singapore, and I'd grown up in Hong Kong. So immediately there was these points of connection. And so I signed up immediately and said, yes, there was only 3 bedrooms in that place, and she was the landlady, and it would be so much more comfortable. And I asked my workmate to give a reference for me, David. David, he wrote down a good reference, a glowing reference, and gave it to Jane, and she accepted me. So on the day that I moved in, I asked David if he could help me shift all my stuff, because he had a car, and all I had was a rusty old mountain bike. And so he helped me move all of my gear into Jane's house. And we were sitting there on the sofa, just relaxing after I moved my things into my new bedroom. And he said to me, very innocently, he said to me, oh, how was church yesterday? Now, he wasn't a believer himself. He was agnostic. But he said to me, oh, how was church yesterday? Because he knew I went to church. And I said, well, you know, it was fine, just, you know, typical kind of church service. But I noticed Jane over in the corner of the room suddenly stiffen and listening to the conversation. And I thought, I didn't really think much about it at the time, but I distinctly remember her doing that. And then later on in the afternoon, we went to one of the English kind of garden farms places, and I was walking up ahead with one of my friends, other friends who'd joined us, and Jane and David were probably about 10 meters or so behind us. And I remember Jane saying, I could just hear her saying, she said to David, why didn't you tell me he was a Christian? And David said to her, "Well, I said he's got no bad habits." And you know, you immediately Jane's thinking like, hang on a minute, you know, bad habits is not the same as being Christian. Not having bad habits is not the same as being Christian. I mean, you can be a very civilized person, but you don't have to be Christian. And so there was that little interchange. And then in the evening, that night, we were sitting there on that same couch. I was sitting on the couch and she was sitting there on the chair. And on the TV, there came the program Songs of Praise. The Songs of Praise, where they go around to the different cathedrals and chapels. They film different church choirs singing or groups singing. And as soon as it came on, Jane reached over to the TV, switched it off, and she turned to me and she said, "Sven, we'll have none of that in this house. I'm an atheist and an evolutionist." And I was just sitting there thinking, like, what does she want me to do? You know, I think, you know, I've gone from this cramped English house, and I've moved into the den of lions. You know, I'm going to be eaten alive by this atheist. And so I just kind of just froze. I was just kind of like, okay, don't move too much. She'll let me out of here, sort of thing. Anyway, so she, it was fine. Nothing really happened. And then over the next few days and weeks and months, she'd come down in the morning and she'd ask me, "Sven, tell me, do you believe in Adam and Eve?" And I go, "Well, yes, I do." And then a few weeks later, she'd come down and say, "Well, do you believe in Noah and the flood?" And I'd say, "Well, yes, I do." And she was sort of interesting. We'd have these interchanges over the years, over the months that I was there. One time she actually asked me, she said, "Sven, do you believe in Balaam and the donkey? You know, the donkey that talked." And so I said to her, "Well, you know, it was a bit like Shrek. You know, there's a talking donkey in Shrek, but God beat Disney to a talking donkey." I didn't know if she really took that one. But anyway, but you know, it was amazing, all of these different type of questions that she would ask me. And then one time I came home. I came home from church one Sabbath afternoon. And she was sitting there at the table with her friend Valerie. Valerie was a lawyer up in Birmingham. And they were eating pizza. And one other thing which was really kind of handy was that Jane was a vegetarian. And so it would mean that anything that she cooked, I could eat as well. But I didn't eat all the food, so just to clear that up. But anyway, so I came home. The Cambridge church was mainly a Jamaican or a West Indian church. And so I had my nice shirt on and tie and rode up in my bike. And there they were sitting there eating vegetarian pizza. And they said to me, "Sven, would you like to join us to have some vegetarian pizza?" And being a bachelor, you know, still growing as I guess young guys always are, I said, "Of course." And I sat down and started to eat the pizza that they hadn't finished. And so we talked about all sorts of things, you know, typical things in England. Weather's a big thing in England. Talked about the politics and you know, sports and the academic research, all of that kind of stuff. And then 20 minutes into the conversation, Valerie turned to me and she said to me, "Sven, where's the evidence that God exists?" And it took me by surprise in terms of I just wasn't expecting that. So I tried to give a response, but it just set me on this journey of just wanting to know more about God and why he exists. And of course, even with Jane and her belief in evolution, the amazing thing is that I'm still in contact with Jane. I just emailed her a week or so ago. We're still talking about all of these things. I've told her that I'm praying that she'll be in heaven with her family and with my family as well. She tells me that she's hoping that I'll come to the dark side. But I believe that God is more powerful than the powers of the dark side. But I want to share with you, that's a bit of background as to one of the reasons or a real reason why I have just this real fascination and interest in this topic. And what I want to do today is share with you some ideas which are very, very powerful from my perspective. Really things which challenge the way you think. And talking about thinking, I want to start off by looking at the human mind, the human brain. And let's see if this will go. Yes, the human brain. Absolutely amazing. You know, it's amazing how much of your day can go by when you don't actually think about the fact that your mind is processing so much data and information. Do you realize that? You know, you can simply go the whole day thinking all sorts of amazing thoughts and listening and seeing things, and yet we take it for granted what our brains are really doing. And if you go into it, the brain is an absolutely incredible organ that we have in our body. Let me give you some of the facts about our brain. First thing, it weighs about 1.5 kgs. Not very big, is it? When you think of your total body weight, only 1.5 g's, but in that 1.5 kg organ, there's 200 billion neurons. Incredible amount of these processing cells in the human brain. Not only that, the human brain is only 2% of our body weight, as you could have worked out from the first point, but it receives 15% of the blood supply, 20% of the oxygen we breathe, and 25% of the glucose from our food. So what it's saying is that our brain is taking up a lot of our energy, a lot of the oxygen that we need, a lot of the blood supply all goes to the brain in really disproportionate kind of amount compared to its actual weight. Incredible, incredible organ in our body. Our brain is three times as large as a chimpanzee's brain, if you compare it using the encephalization quotient, which is a way that the scientists do a comparison to try and make sure that we're comparing apples with apples, shall we say. And finally, if you talk to the neurosurgeons, when they actually go in to do the operations, the brain, the consistency is a bit like soft tofu. So imagine you've got 1.5 kgs of soft tofu, and that's how you do all of the things that you want to do from day to day. That's how you drive, how you calculate how much you're going to spend at Coles or Woolies or Aldi, whichever is your favorite. And, you know, that is the thing that God has given you to think. Isn't it absolutely amazing? Absolutely amazing. And the brain can do some incredible things as well. I'm not sure if you can see it in up on the big screen, but if you focus on this diagram, this pattern, it actually looks like the whole thing is moving, like it's revolving slowly. And it's your brain sort of taking all of those colors and then following it through. Even though, of course, the picture itself is very still. You've got other patterns as well. And if you look at very, very carefully, the discs look like they're spinning. Of course, it's a still image. But your brain is following those colors, seeing a kind of movement in those images. And this is one I really like as well, is can anybody actually read this? Because it's an absolutely mess of letters. Can anybody read it? You can. Yeah? Let me see if you can read what I read. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Now the question is this, how does your brain do it? How when there's such a mess of letters, how can your brain actually read it? And it's because your brain picks up patterns, it picks up cues. Well, the key, of course, is, as you may know from some of the email messages you've got about this riddle or this optical trick, is that the first and last letters always remain the same. So you lock in the first and last letters, but you scramble the middle ones. And so what your brain is doing is it's picking up those endpoints and then unscrambling the letters as you read and going back on your memory as well. Now, of course, this is a little bit of a trick because you know this passage really well. And so, but the thing is, I could have put up another passage which you'd never seen before, and you could still read it. simply because of the ability of the mind to unscramble letters based on markers and patterns and all of those kind of things. Absolutely amazing what the human brain can do. But of course, sometimes the human brain isn't quite as good as we want, is it? I remember I had a friend, a musician in Christchurch, and his brother was schizophrenic. And we would go to talk to Tim's brother. And he'd tell us straight to our face, you know, today I think I'm a 747, you know, and the next day I'm a bus. And you're thinking to yourself, you know, how can his brain actually do this? Why would his brain, you know, think like that? It's not even true. You know, he's not a 747. And the other thing, of course, which is really kind of challenging is, I don't know if you've ever been involved in sort of psychiatric kind of, or talking with psychiatric people or people who have psychological problems, but sometimes even you have to think, is this real? You have to kind of pinch yourself, you know, am I really understanding reality as it should be? Or are we all sort of like out of touch with reality? Really powerful, because if you think about it, it's your brain which allows you to connect with what's happening, to interpret what's happening right here, and to actually understand and to give you the right information too. It's very, very important. And I guess the question is this. You know, if the rationality and intelligence of our mind is so important, where does it come from? How can we be confident in what we believe? Now, of course, some people will tell you that rationality is the domain of a particular group of people, and that group of people is the atheist scientists. That group of people is the atheist evolutionists. And just 4 years ago, there was a conference down in Melbourne where they had the greatest, or the loudest, maybe I should say, the noisiest atheists from around the world. The four horsemen there, Richard Dawkins, Sam Harris, and those guys as well. And of course, what they say is, you know, it's a celebration of reason. A celebration of reason. You know, if you want to be rational, if you want to be people who are grounded in the physical reality of where we live, you need to be an atheist and an evolutionist. Put those together. If you want to be intelligent, you need to follow science where it leads. And of course, you know, you go to those conferences and there's a lot of joking, a lot of laughing about people who don't believe that way. And of course, you have quotes like this from Richard Dawkins. It's absolutely safe to say that if you meet somebody who claims not to believe in evolution, that person is ignorant, stupid, or insane, or wicked, but I'd rather not consider that. So Richard Dawkins has a lot of friendly and kind words for people who don't believe in evolution. Now, of course, we need to be careful here as to what he means by evolution, because it's certainly true that as we go through life, as biological life continues, there is genetic diversification, there's adaptation, all of those kind of things. So there's evolutionary processes can be occurring. But of course, what Richard Dawkins is really talking about here is not just the genetic diversification, not just the concept that our offspring can have a different set of genes and mutations can occur. No, what he's talking about is the theory of common ancestry, that we all evolved from a common ancestor way back billions of years ago, that we have a common ancestor with chimpanzees and chihuahuas and bananas and all the rest of it. That's what he's really talking about. He's saying, you know, if you don't believe it, you're ignorant and stupid or insane or possibly wicked as well, simply because you won't do it. The other thing, of course, is he's got something to say about faith too. So come across to his quote on faith. He says, faith is a great cop-out. Faith is a great cop-out. So if any of you have faith in this room today, in this auditorium today, you are following a great cop-out. The great excuse to evade the need to think. Notice that point there. The need to think and evaluate evidence. Faith is belief in spite of, or even perhaps because of, the lack of evidence. So if you believe something by faith, you're doing it because there is no evidence. You're not willing to think. You're not willing to look for evidence and where it leads. You're simply using it as an excuse. And that is his comment here. Yeah, powerful stuff. And Richard Dawkins is open to his own viewpoints. But I guess the question I want to follow through today is Richard Dawkins right? Is Richard Dawkins right? Or is there something else going on here and something very powerful as well? And I want to come back to one of his favorite topics, which of course is DNA. DNA, deoxyribonucleic nucleic acid. Very, very powerful chemical or molecule that, of course, each and every one of us are built on. This is the very building blocks of biological life. This is where all of the information about you is encoded. In your cell, all of your DNA amounts to about 2 meters high. So if you thread it all out, so you've got a lot of it in your cells. But this is the question. It's a beautiful helix structure, like a spiral staircase. And that's what Crick and Watson found when they were working at Cambridge. But to go into that, of course, if you go into DNA, what you need for DNA to work, for life to work, for evolution to work, so to speak, you need an incredible system to actually be working. First of all, you need an alphabet. So like the Scrabble letters there, you need letters that can store this information, A, T, C, G. You need all of those letters. It's got 4 letters in DNA compared to our 26 in the English alphabet. You need that to start off with. The next thing you need is the genetic code. The genetic code is you take 3 of those letters and they correspond to your amino acids. So each one, and there's actually redundancy as well. So you can have multiple symbols or multiple codons for each of the amino acids. So you need that as well. The other thing, of course, you need as well is a decoder to actually decode the information, just like you'd have for your HOPE or a 3ABN channel. You need that for your DNA as well. And of course, not only do you need your encoder or decoder, you also need your protein factory. Your factory which can take all of this information and actually pump out, produce all of these proteins. So you need all of these even before evolution has even got off the ground. Amazing, amazing reality. So, and this is the critical issue for evolution. How did this system come into existence? Where did it come from? And there is no answer in science. There is no answer in evolution for this system as it stands. And of course, I look at this coming from the background of electrical engineering and computer networking. And I look at this and I say, you know, there is design in that. There's an intelligence which goes behind all of that. To have an alphabet system, to have these codes for amino acids, to have a decoder, and to have that factory as well. Really, really powerful evidence of design. And it's funny, when I was talking with Jane, she talked to me about mitochondria. And she said to me, you know, there's errors in the mitochondria. And if you map that with our chimpanzees, then our mitochondria kind of looks a bit like ours. And there you have it. There's evidence of evolution, that we came from, or we had a common ancestor with chimpanzees. But as she explained it to me, what she said, you know, there's these error codes with these codons. And as you go through, there's processes which actually decode the errors, or there's error correction codes as well. And I was sitting there thinking to myself, there's evidence of design. The very thing which she was sharing with me to demonstrate evolution, for me, was powerful evidence for design. But continuing on from here with the DNA, one of the things, going back to computer networking and computer software as well, is one of the things you don't want in your software is bugs in your software, or errors. And I remember sitting at my computers when I was doing my PhD, and you'd be running your software on the Sun workstation, running it through Unix, and you get sort of like 20 minutes in, and suddenly, bang, it would come up, segmentation fault. There's a bug, there's a problem in your error in your software. And it was so infuriating. The other thing as well is I've started a string ensemble in Sydney, and my co-leader is a software programmer, and he'll come in and say, look, it's so infuriating. You know, I can't find this error in the software. It's somewhere in the library. And all of this points back to the fact that, you know, when you have errors, when you have problems in the software, most of the time it's crippling to the system, crippling to where we want to go as well. Not only that as well, it's fascinating to reflect what's happening in the DNA as well. Most of the time, when you have, say, you know, lectures from people who are involved in science, they'll be looking at the DNA, so that double helix strand there with all of the letters in between, and they'll talk about the genes and how this is a Darwin finch. Now, if you change one of the genes of the Darwin finch, its beak will get longer. And so if you've got one of those errors coming along, you will find that you've got two Darwin finches. So the parent finch has a shorter beak and the offspring has a longer beak. And depending on the environment, the finch or the group of finches which are better suited to that environment, they'll be the ones that survive. But what the thing is that is not often shared is that DNA is so much more interesting and complicated than just that single strand. Sometimes we think of it just like a piece of wool where we can go in and change individual letters and genes, and then we'll change the size of the beak of the finch. But in actual fact, it's so much more interesting than that. Did you realize that every single day, in every single cell in your body, there's over 1 million destructive events that happen inside your DNA? Did you realize that? There's breakages, there's things which are happening with those letters. And what happens in the DNA is that they've got these little enzymes, these little machines, which run along the DNA. So this is DNA ligase, and it's going along repairing the DNA. Absolutely amazing, isn't it? That you've got this system, this process, which is going to check all of those errors, those damage which is being done inside your cells. 1 million damages per day in each of your cells. And these enzymes are going along correcting all of that, trying to make sure your DNA stays intact. DNA is actually a very fragile molecule. But here's the catch. Where is the information stored to actually build those enzymes which repair the DNA? Where do you think it's stored? It's actually stored in the DNA as well, yes. It's actually stored in the DNA. So what you have here is you have that to repair DNA, you need DNA to actually build the enzymes to do the repair. Does that make sense? It's the classic kind of what they call a chicken and the egg scenario. So you need the DNA for the enzymes. You need the enzymes to repair your DNA. How do you get that? Through a process of evolution, of mutations, of things being damaged and then changes being made. It's absolutely amazing. Not only this, is that we... In DNA, often we think, well, it's a long strand, and you change a gene here or change a letter here, and of course that's going to change the length of the beak of your Darwin finch. The actual, in actual fact, the DNA is much more intricate than that. In fact, our DNA is more like what they would call a RNA supercomputer, And so it's very, very interconnected. So this gene will actually control a whole lot of other things, like all of those lines there. They will impact a whole lot of the outputs of this supercomputer. And if you compare it with Linux, which is one of the software systems that people use, what you'll notice here is that the top two, so the yellow bars at the top and the purple bars, are shorter. So Linux is much wider for the yellow and the purple, and the green part is much shorter. The green part is what you're getting out of that computer. So what it's saying here is that the DNA is this very interconnected, but it's also very efficient because it can, with a small amount of instructions, it can do a lot, if that makes sense. But going on from that as well, not only is DNA just it's not just a string of letters. DNA is actually folded up in each of your cells into this kind of ball, like a ball of wool. And so scientists have noticed that there's sometimes a gene here which is involved with a gene there, and they go like, what about everything in the middle? They say, is that junk DNA? No, it's not. When you fold it, the genes come closer together to the point where they need it. And the fascinating thing is this, is that over time, this ball of DNA actually changes its shape depending on what you need for your the proteins that are made in your body. It's absolutely amazing. So it's not just changing the letters, as the neo-Darwinists would say. It's also the change of the shape as well. Incredible, incredible reality of DNA. Another fascinating part of our body or our cells is mitochondria. Mitochondria are these little tiny power units inside your cells. There you can see some of them. They're these little tiny organelles, as they call them, which change glucose into ATP. So they're the power engines of your cell system. But the amazing thing is this, is that first of all, they've got their own little threads of DNA in the mitochondria. But what scientists have observed is that you can actually trace all of the mitochondrial DNA back to one single woman in history. One single woman, she's called mitochondrial Eve. And if you use real-world mutation rates, that person, that woman, lived about 6,000 years ago. Absolutely amazing. Now, it's very important to clarify here that this is not proving that that Eve existed. This is not it's not science proving Eve. But what it is saying is that this is consistent with what we have in the Bible as well. Absolutely amazing. And when I look at all of that, as a person that's been involved in software and information system and things like that, I say that looks like design. That looks like intelligence. There's a rationality behind that which has led to us actually having the information that we need. Not only that, there's this whole concept of population dynamics as well. One of the things which is very fascinating about the human race is that our genetic distribution, or the distribution of our genome, is actually quite small, quite narrow, which means that we all came from a very small, select group of people. And so what evolutionists have done is that they've said we need to go from this population that goes way, way back from their perspective, but suddenly there's a catastrophe which takes the population of human beings down to a very, very low number, and then bounces back up to where we are today. But when you think about that, once again, that's consistent with the Bible. And what we have here, of course, is the biblical timeline would be that God created Adam and Eve. They reproduced, multiplied, expanded up, and suddenly dropped down because of the flood, down to 8 individuals as well. There's a consistency that we can really see here as well. Absolutely amazing. But I want to go to an even more significant thing, going back to our concept of the mind. You know, Darwin himself was a person who reflected incredibly on what he was presenting to the scientific world. But this comment here to a person called William Graham is really quite profound. What he says is this: "But then with me, the horrid doubt always arises. whether the convictions of man's mind, which has been developed from the mind of lower animals, are of any value at all, or at all trustworthy. Would anyone trust in the convictions of a monkey's mind if there are any convictions in such a mind? Do you get what he's saying here? What he's saying here is this, is if we evolved, why would you trust our minds? Why would you trust our thinking? And he says this, you know, would I trust the thinking of what a monkey is thinking about, the thoughts of a monkey, what a monkey is reflecting on? And I remember talking about this at a presentation in Brisbane, and there was a professor of physics there, and he said, well, you know, of course, we have no idea what monkey's thinking about. Well, that's fine. That's true. You don't know what a monkey's thinking about. But the question is this, why would you trust a monkey? Why would you make the assumption that the monkey's mind is trustworthy? That's the problem. And that is what we always do with our own minds. And this is the point. You know, I'm standing here trusting that you have the intelligence, whether you're online or whether you're sitting here this morning, that you have the intelligence to be listening to what I'm saying, to be evaluating it and seeing what you whether you think that what is on the screen is true. What he's saying is really this, that naturalistic evolution destroys our confidence in human intelligence. It destroys our confidence in human intelligence. Now, in that same letter, he went on to say, but I'm not very well versed, I'm not very well trained in abstract reasoning, saying it was more of a philosophical issue. But I want to take you through a few quotes, a few comments by leading thinkers down through history to see what they say about the same issue as well. Think of C.S. Lewis. Come with me to C.S. Lewis. Unless human reasoning is valid, no science can be true. Have you thought about that? Unless human reasoning is valid, no science can be true. A theory which explained everything else in the whole universe, but which made it impossible to believe that our thinking was valid, would be utterly out of court. Utterly out of court. For that theory would itself have been reached by thinking. And if thinking is not valid, that theory would, of course, be itself demolished. It would have destroyed its own credentials. And C.S. Lewis goes on, and of course, for the naturalist, the process of evolution was not designed to produce a mental behavior that can find truth. And he goes, this imposes on him or her the very embarrassing task of trying to show how the evolutionary product, which he or she has described, could also be a power of seeing truths. But he goes on to say, but the very attempt is absurd. What he's saying is this, exactly the same thing. Naturalistic evolution destroys our confidence in human intelligence. Well, okay, well, that's C.S. Lewis. What about Friedrich Nietzsche? Nietzsche was the guy who wrote that amazing parable about this madman who comes into this courtyard, this town center, lights this lamp, and he runs around this courtyard saying, I see God, I see God. And the people in the town are laughing at him. Why are you seeking God? Why are you seeking God? And he stops and he says, you know, we have killed him. We have killed God, and he throws his lantern down into the courtyard. But this is what Friedrich Nietzsche says. Indeed, only if we assume a God who is morally our light can truth and the search for truth be at all something meaningful and promising for success. This God left aside, if we push God out of the picture, the question is permitted whether being deceived is not one of the conditions of life. To summarize it, the exact same thing. Naturalistic evolution destroys our confidence in human intelligence. That is exactly what Nietzsche is saying as well. Okay, so some of you may not enjoy Nietzsche so well, but you may be more interested in a more contemporary New York philosopher. And he say, if we came to believe that our capacity for objective theory were the product of natural selection, that would warrant serious skepticism about its results. Big words, but once again, what he's saying is naturalistic evolution destroys our confidence in human intelligence. Same idea, same concept. And then we have the Canadian philosopher as well. He says, there's an embarrassing absurdity in naturalism or atheism. that is revealed as soon as the naturalist reflects and acknowledges that he believes his naturalistic theory of the world. I mean, he cannot say it and consistently regard it as true. You cannot be an atheist and say it's true. That's what he's saying here. Same thing, naturalistic evolution destroys our confidence in human intelligence. Then we go to this philosopher of science down in San Diego. And she kind of gives us the picture. This is what is actually happening with science. What's happening with evolution? She puts it in very sort of bald kind of facts. Boiled down to essentials, a nervous system enables that organism to succeed in the four basic biological functions: feeding, fighting, fleeing, and reproducing. The principal core, the job of the nervous system, your brain, is to get the body parts where they should be in order that the organism may survive. So what she's saying is that the purpose of my brain is simply to get my body from there over to here. If I need to run away or fight, or if there's a beautiful woman, or if I want to get some food. Improvements in the sensory motory control, talking about the brain, confer an evolutionary advantage. A fancier style of representing is advantageous so long as it is geared to the organism's way of life and enhances the organism's chance of survival. And this last sentence is really important. Truth, whatever that is, definitely takes the hindmost. She says, in evolution, truth takes the back seat. Truth takes the back seat. What she's saying as well is that naturalistic evolution destroys our confidence in human intelligence. So those are some of the atheistic philosophers and scientists. There's even guys in Christianity as well. John Lennox is one of the really significant Christian apologists, works at Oxford University as a mathematician and philosopher of science. And he says this: if Crick's thesis is true, if talking about evolution, we could never know it. For not only does it relegate our experiences of beauty and moral obligation and religious encounter to the epiphenomenal scrap heap, it also destroys rationality as well. Same conclusion. Naturalistic evolution destroys our confidence in human intelligence. And then we come to a really, really powerful Christian philosopher, Alvin Plantinga. And he's developed this concept very, very rigorously in what he calls the evolutionary argument against naturalism. EAAN, shows that if someone accepts naturalistic evolution and sees that the probability of having reliable cognitive faculties is low, then that person is a defeater for their belief in naturalistic evolution. Same conclusion, naturalistic evolution destroys our confidence in human intelligence. And to summarize what Alvin Plantinga is saying, he's really saying this: it's irrational to be an atheist and believe in evolution. Have you thought about that? It's irrational for Richard Dawkins to say he's an atheist and believe in evolution. Why is that irrational? Because he's putting his faith, remember faith? Faith, he's putting his faith in his own intelligence, but he has no reason to trust his own intelligence. Does that make sense? It's completely, he has no grounds to do it because evolution does not give him the grounds to do it. And why does it do that? Let me just bring it down, because there's lots of big words. Look, I know that. There's lots of big words and all of that. The problem here is that you've got evolution. Evolution is driving towards a particular kind of goal. And the goal is survival. It's about helping you survive. But the thing is that truth is not the same as survival. That's the point. Does that make sense? Truth is not the same as survival. Of course, there are times where you can, it can reach truth, but it's not all the time. And that is the big thing. As Patricia Churchland said, truth takes the back seat. If truth gets there, fantastic. If it doesn't, well, evolution couldn't get us there. This is the issue. This is the issue. It is irrational to believe, to be an atheist and believe in evolution. That's to sum it all up. Now, of course, some people will say, well, what about if we added a little bit of God to the recipe? Yeah? What if we added a little bit of salt to the soup of evolution, add a pinch of God to the recipe? Can we get out of our predicament here? But the point is this. It's really important to understand what's going on here, because God could have created human brains for a number of other purposes other than being able to discern the truth. Okay, so follow along with me carefully here. Remember, evolution focuses on survival, right? The evolution wants to get your body to a place where you can survive. Whereas what we need to know that something is true, we need to focus on truth. So the issue here is that what is the purpose, what is the function of the brain? And the thing is that God could have created our brains for any number of reasons, correct? He could have created us for a number of reasons. Let me give you some examples. God could have just wound up the cosmic clock, and set it off like a clock, and then just let it go. This is the sort of deistic kind of approach. William Miller was a deist. But basically the idea is that God started it all off, and then just, he doesn't care anything about what happens, just lets it run. But of course, this enters the same problem that that evolution, because God is doing nothing along this pathway of evolution. We could have ended up anywhere. And of course, the purpose of evolution is for our survival. So God has no control over this process, or he doesn't exert any control. So deistic evolution does not allow us to get to the point where we can say, yes, this is true. But the other thing as well, God could have had other things that he wanted to do with our brains as well. He could have just made us to be like other animals, right? So we just happen to be a fancy animal. So you've got your fly there, your eagle, the tiger, and your good chimpanzee. So he could have evolved all of us or guided our evolution so that we're something like a tiger or something like a chimpanzee. But the problem here is that, you know, if you go through the animal kingdom, where do you find rationality? Where do you find intelligence that you want to have for human beings? You don't. As much as I like tigers, I would never say I trust their brains in terms of quantum mechanics or metaphysics or biology. They're simply biological machines to survive. That's the whole purpose. I might accept, well, they're pretty good. They run pretty well. They fight. They can catch antelope really well or whatever. But I wouldn't say that I'd trust their thinking with regards to rationality. I wouldn't do it. And so the question is this: if God just made us so we like other animals, we shouldn't put so much confidence in our ability to think. We shouldn't do it. It's simply irrational. But what about this? Maybe God designed us as just very exquisite fiction generators. You know, like Harry Potter. Maybe God just wanted us, you know, a machines that just created stories. You know, amazing stories about the universe, about biology, about evolution. Why not? You know, maybe God thought that would be very fascinating. Maybe it's sort of like an artist, you know, generating these, like computer games. What about, you know, we just generate these kind of fiction. That could have been a possibility as well, and a very real possibility. Because I ask you as you go around the world, you know, you've got your Hindu gods, Krishna, and all of those kind of people. You have your philosophies, you know, in Buddhism and all of the Aztecs. There's a lot of, you know, falsehood in all of that. There's a lot of fiction, a lot of myths. What about if God just created us as fiction generators? Or what about this? What if God created our mind to be like Google Translate? Have you ever tried Google Translate? It's actually really funny. It's and look, it's Google. Google's doing it for a good reason. He's doing it for a very good. They do it for a very good reason because they want you to understand other languages. But it's very funny. I remember we went to Vietnam, and we were running some training for house church leaders in Cambodia. There were people from Vietnam. And that's another amazing story. If I have time, I'll tell you that one as well. But we wanted to, they of course didn't understand English so well. And so we wanted to make sure that our presentations and our slides were meaningful to these Vietnamese house church leaders. And we talked to Isaac and the person who was hosting us. We said, could you tell us who would be a good translator for us. And being the busy person that he was living in California, would fly over to Cambodia. He just didn't get back to us for a long time. So then we knew of some Vietnamese people in Perth, because I was working in Perth at the time. So they weren't Christians. So we said to them, could you help us translate it? So we gave them some, and they sent it back to us. And they said, look, it's so much theology. There's so much, difficult words. We just don't have time. You know, there's pages and pages of it. So finally we got to the point where we said, we're going to have to use Google Translate. So we took our Word documents, we pasted it in Google Translate, and out came Vietnamese. Amazing. Really, really cool. You know, all looks great. And we copied all of the text, we put it up on the screen, and we took it over there confident in our Vietnamese presentations. And we got up there, we put it up, and then the laughter, the absolute, you know, they were rolling off their seats in terms of what we were trying to say, you know. And they said, you know, the funniest things you're putting up on the screen. So to give you a bit of a laugh this morning, I thought I'd give you a local South Australian experience. How about that? So I don't know about you, but if you knew about it, but there was a man who was trapped under a bus in the CBD. It was on the Advertiser, and it was most viewed last week. And sort of nice kind of story about how he got out of the bus. So I put it in Google Translate, and I decided I'd translate into Chinese. So it's always nice to go to another completely different language. But so here's the story for the rest of that news article. A man has avoided major injury after he was struck by a bus outside the festival centre in the Adelaide CBD. Emergency service crews were able to free the man who became trapped under the bus on King William Road about 11:20 on Tuesday. The man, 44, was crossing the road when he collided with the bus on its passenger side and went under the bus behind the front left wheel. He was freed before being taken to the Royal Adelaide Hospital with low blood pressure and shock, an SA ambulance spokeswoman said. Witness Christopher Thomas, who was first to arrive on the scene, said he saw the bus stop in the middle of King William Road with its hazard lights on. I saw somebody under the bus and I thought it could have been the driver fixing something, but quickly I saw that it was not, he said. Kind of nice story. The guy got out really nice. Well, so what does Google translate? So you translate into Chinese and then do the translate back again. Here's what it says in Google. A person has to avoid serious injury. He was a bus outside the centre section located after the Adelaide CBD occurred. Emergency service personnel to free man Tuesday who became trapped on the bus, King William Road, about 11:20. The man, aged 44, was crossing the street when he collided with the bus with its passenger side, front wheel, and the left rear of the bus to the next. He was taken to Royal Adelaide Hospital, hypertension and shock before being released, a SA ambulance spokesman said. Witness Christopher Thomas, who was first to arrive at the scene, said he saw the bus in the middle of the King William Road stopping its hazard lights. I looked at the bus. I think this may be the driver fixing things, but soon I see that it's not, he said. It's, you know, there's some really funny things in that, that article, because you've done the translate, back again. And, if you can do it, you can get a really funny translation. It's really quite hilarious. But the fact is this, is that God could have produced our minds like a Google Translate. You know, take all of that information about reality, process it, and then tell the story. But you get a whole lot of things wrong, right? And you don't exactly know where you get things wrong. You know, it says this person was a bus outside the city section. And it's just a bit of a laugh. Maybe God did it like that. Maybe he thought it would be hilarious for us to go around like Google Translators. The fact is this, is that there's any number of reasons why God could have created our brains. And we can't assume that God created our brains to be able to recognize truth. So theistic evolution also destroys our confidence in human intelligence. It also destroys our confidence in human intelligence. Therefore, it is irrational to believe in theistic evolution. And the point is this, it's important to get the point really clearly, is that truth is in this direction, based on where I'm sort of focusing on. But God could have had a whole range of other reasons to create our brains. Does that make sense? God could have given us a whole other way, reasons for creating our minds and intelligence. And we don't have any reason to know which one of those he chose, why he chose it, and which ones he actually did. I don't know about you, it's kind of a bit sort of like, yo, what do we do now? Where do we go? And I think the words of King Solomon are really powerful here. You know, King Solomon, one of the wisest persons in the Bible, one of the most studied, educated people who studied biology and birds and all of those kind of things, he, at the end of his life, wrote this: "I, the teacher, was king of Israel, and I lived in Jerusalem. I devoted myself to search for understanding and to explore by wisdom everything being done under heaven. I soon discovered that God has dealt a tragic existence to the human race. I observed everything going on under the sun, and really, it is all meaningless, like chasing the wind." And that phrase there, under the sun, it's a very important phrase in Ecclesiastes, very powerful book if you want to read through it. Under the sun is his term to say, this is what it's like to live life without God. To search for meaning, for reasons, for understanding without God. And he says at the end of it all, it's all meaningless. It's all meaningless. It reminds me of another passage in the New Testament, in Romans, the first chapter in Romans, where it says this: "For what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made, so that they are without excuse. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking." Notice that phrase there. "They became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of immortal God for images representing mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things." What's he talking about? He's talking about the idolatry of that age. And he says, once you take your mind off God, once you are no longer willing to acknowledge God for who he is and his revelation to us, and you start focusing on the things around us, man and birds and animals and creeping things, your minds and hearts darkened. You claim to be wise, but you become fools. You become fools. Now, of course, some of us might be saying here, well, of course, that's back then. We would never worship Baals. We would never worship Astaroths. We would never worship Zeus or Olympus or any of those kind of things. We would never be like the Israelites who gave into all of that idolatry. But I want you to stop for a minute. I want you to stop for a minute and think about, what were they actually doing when they worshipped Baal and Astaroth? What were they actually doing? Because I'd like to say to you this, is that, you know, Baal worship back then was actually the science of that time. Do you realize that? It was the science of that time. Because what Baal wasn't just an image where you go and worship. No, Baal was their explanation of how things worked. Baal was the explanation of where rain came from. The idols were the explanation of how fertility worked. All of those kind of things. And so what they were saying is, we worship, rather than the creator God of the universe, we explain it through a different way. And what the Israelites were saying is that we need to incorporate, we need to bring in, we need to integrate the science of our time with our understanding of God. We need to do this. And so they would worship Baal on the high places, and then they would go to Jerusalem. They would do both. But of course, what happened was that in claiming to be wise, in claiming to say we will take the science of our time, which disregards God, they became darkened, they became fools. They became futile in their thinking. And we need to be very, very aware of this. We need to be very careful of this as well. You know, in Ecclesiastes, right at the end, after all of that incredible soul-searching and the incredible reality of the meaninglessness of life under the sun without God, Solomon comes up with this final conclusion. Now all has been heard. Here is the conclusion of the matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the duty of all mankind. Remember your Creator in your days of the youth. This wisest man, this person who understood the science of his time, who integrated Baal and other worship into his society, came to the point and he said, we really need to go back to the Creator. And talking about commandments and remembering, it reminds me of a very powerful commandment that we have right at the heart. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. For in 6 days, the Lord God, Lord made heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the seventh day and made it holy. For me, there's a powerful connection there between what Ecclesiastes, what Solomon was saying, and right at the heart of the Ten Commandments, a pointer to the Creator of our universe. And right, if we go back to that original creation account, the original account of how God created this world, right at the heart of it says this, then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over the livestock and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Church, this morning, I want to give you a very clear message. You are not evolved from other animals. You're not evolved from a common ancestor with chimpanzees. You have been made in the image of God. You've been made in the very image of the Almighty God of this universe, this Creator of this universe. And let me say to you this, that this is the only reason why you can have confidence in human intelligence, in your own intelligence, and in the intelligence of your doctor when you go to see your doctor, when you go to your lawyer, when you're on the bus and you're trusting the bus driver, when you're flying on a plane, flying up to Sydney, or across to LA. The only reason that you have confidence in the intelligence of those people is because they're made in the image of God. That's the only reason that we can have confidence. And I want to conclude with you this afternoon this. It is only when we worship God as Creator and accept his account of how he created us in his image that we can reach our highest intellectual potential. That is the reason. And I want to encourage you, worship the God that created you. Know the God that created you in his image, because it's only then that we can really, really be all that God wanted us to be. Let's pray. Father in heaven, I just want to thank you for this opportunity that we have this morning to really dive into such an important topic. Lord, where did we come from? Why are we here? What's the purpose of what we're doing here on earth? And I just want to thank you, Lord, that you have revealed to us your plan, the way that you created us, that you were so amazing that you were willing to stoop down to sculpt us out of clay originally, and then to create us in your image, breathe in us the breath of life. And Lord, when we look at ourselves, when we look at the animals around us, when our focus is taken off you, our confidence, even in our own minds, is completely destroyed. We cannot understand the world around us. It's only when we look to you, only when we recognize that you are the foundation of our intelligence, when we're willing to humble ourselves rather than try and trust in our own understanding. And Father, I just want to pray for your blessing over your church here this afternoon, but also want to pray for the South Australian Conference as well. Because, Lord, I know that there's young people at university, there's teachers, there's pastors who may be even struggling with this very issue. And Lord, I pray that through your Holy Spirit, you would just reveal yourself in a very powerful way and confirm in our minds the truth of the account of creation in Genesis 1 and 2. And Lord, I just want to thank you for being the loving God that you are, that you not only created a world where there was no pain and suffering, that it was not about the survival of the fittest and animals dying and killing each other, but you created a perfect world. And that gives us hope and a promise that you'll be able to create a perfect world in the future, in the very near future, is our prayer. So Lord, we want to go away with your blessing. Go away sort of living life under the knowledge and the awareness of your presence, being willing to acknowledge you, humble ourselves before you, and ultimately relish in your love and your blessings is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.